Okay, good morning. Good morning to all our comers. I'm Ron Dlumi, board member of Amen Israel. We'll open this morning with a session about updates on the current diagnosis and treatment. The session, we are honored by the presence of Dr. Sonia Zygmunt. Dr. Sonia Zygmunt is the head of the Department of Hematology in Amsterdam, VU Medical Center in Amsterdam. Dr. Zygmunt will guide us through how myeloma and other related diseases such as amyloidosis are currently diagnosed and treated. The session will last until 10 o'clock. We will leave time for questions and answers at the end of the session. So without further notice, please, Dr. Zygmunt, the floor is yours.
Good morning. Well, thank you very much for this kind invitation. I'm from Amsterdam. This is our research building, and I'm working in close collaboration with Henk Lokhorst and Niels van der Donk and Inge Nijhoff, and they will be happy to be later in future meetings with you here. I want to give a short update on the current diagnosis and the treatment of myeloma. Of course, I will leave amyloid to Professor Mellini because he knows much more. I have some four slides as a muse, and then Professor Mellini will talk on that later. So the things I will discuss is, are we diagnosing multiple myeloma earlier than before and therefore treating also earlier than before? I want to talk about the treatment of the younger patients who are transplant eligible, the treatment of the older patients who are in general not transplant eligible, what to do when the diseases when the disease relapse, and also a short notice on the novel developments, but that will also be later in the program, so I will have only a few slides on that and a few slides on amyloidosis. So the diagnosis of multiple myeloma earlier than before. So there are now novel criteria for the diagnosis of multiple myeloma, and they appeared in the end of 2014, and that leads to an earlier treatment. So there were patients with asymptomatic multiple myeloma whom we did not treat, and now we start treatment earlier already. And that is, of course, to prevent the symptoms of especially bone disease. Probably you know this picture. It's one of the first patients that has been described in the literature in 1844. And you see here the devastating effects of bone disease. And especially you and the doctors want to prevent the development of bone disease, and therefore you would like to treat earlier in time. On the other hand, when you do the oath as a doctor, the first thing you promise is to do no harm. So when you start treatment earlier, you all know that you will experience side effects of the treatment. So you should have a benefit from the treatment, which is more than the side effects that occurs during the treatment. So what we did in the past, only when there were Krebs symptoms, so when you had a high calcium, renal failure, anemia, bone disease, you started treatment of multiple myeloma. But actually from a Spanish investigator group, so the PETIMA, led by Dr. Marivy Mateos and Dr. Jesus San Miguel, they started to treat patients with smoldering myeloma, so patients without any symptoms. And they started to treat those patients with lenalidomide and dexamethasone. And the other half of the patients were not treated. And what you can appreciate from these curves is that when you start treatment here, the blue line, you see that the progression of the disease is less than when you give no treatment. And you would have expected that, because when you start treatment, you will delay the development of the symptoms. So every time a patient develops a symptom, the line goes down. And here, less patients do develop symptoms than when you give no treatment. But the other, even more important observation was that when you started treatment earlier, also more patients did survive. So the overall survival was also better. So you did not only delay the disease symptoms, but patients also survived longer. And that was actually very important because then the benefit-risk ratio is very positive. So then we asked ourselves, should we start earlier treatment and in whom we should start? Because not every patient with smoldering multiple myeloma will develop symptoms in short notice. There are also patients with smoldering myeloma for years not developing symptoms, and you wouldn't like to treat these patients. So what actually is smoldering myeloma? How we diagnose smoldering myeloma? So whenever you have more plasma cells than 10% in the bone marrow, or your M protein level is high and you had no CREP, you would say this is smoldering myeloma. And 8 to 20% of the patients who have a diagnosis of multiple myeloma have smoldering myeloma, so no CREP symptoms. So what is the natural course of the patients? So when you look to these patients with smoldering myeloma, how the natural course is? So here you see the patients with smoldering myeloma and the risk of the chance to develop multiple myeloma. And what you can appreciate from this slide, that in the first 5 years, patients have 10% risk to develop multiple myeloma. But after 5 years, the risk is less. Then it's 3% per year after 5 to 10 years. And thereafter, only 1% of the patients do develop multiple myeloma. So whenever you don't develop multiple myeloma in the first 5 years, there's the risk to develop multiple myeloma later on is lower. So who are these patients? As a doctor, could you predict which patients will develop multiple myeloma with symptoms in short notice, in short time? Because these patients you would like to treat to prevent the development of symptoms. And actually what we did in the myeloma community, we said whenever we are able to predict who will develop multiple myeloma in 2 years with a 70 to 80% risk, those patients you would like to treat early. So when in the first 2 years, 70 to 80% of the patients would have developed multiple myeloma, then we would say, these patients you really should treat because the benefit-risk ratio is positive. You will have more benefit than risk. So there's several methods to now predict whom will develop multiple myeloma with a 70-80% risk in 2 years. One is, here you see the normal immunoglobulin. So every normal person has antibodies in his or her body in order to protect against infections. Patients with multiple myeloma, you know, probably have a monoclonal M protein, so only one type of immunoglobulin. And the immunoglobulin consists of two heavy chains, the orange bars, and two light chains. So what you can see in patients with multiple myeloma, that they have an M protein which is increased, which sometimes is the whole M protein, so both the heavy change and the light change. But some of the patients have an additional production only of the light change. And when you look to the light change, you could have a look to the free light chain ratio, so the kappa and the lambda ratio. So because you have two types of light chains, kappa and lambda. And whenever the ratio is abnormal, you know that these are monoclonal. Now, when the ratio is more than 100, so the malignant chain, either kappa or lambda, is 100% higher than the normal chain, and that occurs in 15% of the patients, you have a 72% risk to develop symptoms in 2 years. So now we don't only treat patients with Krebs symptoms, but also patients without symptoms, but with such a ratio of the kappa and lambda change, we now start to treat those patients already before the development of symptoms. That's also applicable to the patients when you do a bone marrow and you look how many malignant plasma cells are in the bone marrow. The patients who have more than 60% of malignant plasma cells in their bone marrow, so depicted here are the malignant plasma cells, when they're more than 60% in the bone marrow, 95% of the patients will develop symptoms in 2 years. So whenever you perform a bone marrow and there are more than 60% of plasma cells and there are no Krebs symptoms, now we start treatment already in those patients, because almost all the patients will develop multiple myeloma in 2 years. Some of the symptoms are really devastating, like bone disease or renal failure. So we start treatment already. Well, the other thing has to do with a football player. We have a very famous football player in the Netherlands, which is Johan Cruyff, who happily deceased. But he had very specific remarks. And one of his statements was, you only see it when you get it. And I would say in multiple myeloma, that might be too late. And now it comes to the next slide, because you probably all know that we have several techniques to investigate bone disease. And when you investigate bone disease with a classical X-ray, like here, this is just a perfectly normal classical X-ray of a patient. And as a doctor, you would say to the patients, you don't have bone disease, nothing the matter. But when you do an MRI of the same patient, this is the same patient, you can see here that there's a myeloma lesion. So you would have said no bone disease when using classical X-rays, but when you do an MRI, you would say to the patient, you have myeloma bone disease. And when you perform either a CT scan, which is the only the bony structures without the colors, you could already observe here also a lesion, which is the same lesion. But when you also add a radio-labeled sugar, you can even see that the lesion is also active. So when you either perform an MRI or a CT scan, your sensitivity to detect bone disease is much higher. And when you have bone disease, you would like to stop that and start treatment. So that's the third reason now to already start treatment in patients without CREP to the classical definition. Whenever you have an MRI, not with one, but with more than one focal lesion, 70% of the patients will develop symptoms in 2 years. So also these patients are now being treated. And that brings me to the CREP criteria. So we don't only treat patients now with CREP, with the classical symptoms, so hypercalcemia, renal failure, anemia, bone disease, but we will also treat patients now with plasma cells more than 60% in the bone marrow, MRI more than one lesion, and an FLC ratio which is higher than 100, because these patients will develop symptoms in relatively short time. There's one other thing. I know that in many countries there's no access to the CT scan, but actually we would favor to do CT scans in every patient who comes to the clinic because of the suspicion of multiple myeloma. Because when you look to the CT scan and you would observe an osteolytic lesion like this, which you won't see with a classical X-ray, you can already observe from here that it is very important to treat this patient, because this is already maybe collapsing in several months, and you really would like to prevent that. So whenever there's an access to a CT scan, we would like to do a CT scan in every patient with the suspicion of the diagnosis of multiple myeloma. It doesn't need to be a PET CT scan. A PET CT scan costs approximately 1,200 euros. Maybe in some countries the price is less, but approximately 1,200 euros. Whereas just a plain CT scan is approximately 200 euros. And it's also more convenient to the patients, because when you have your classical X-ray, some of you will know, you'll have to need 12 to do 12 photos, which is rather complicated, and a CT scan is being done in 2 minutes. And in most countries, it's not more expensive than just classical X-rays. So we would favor to do a CT scan. Whenever you see one lesion of more than 5 millimeters, you would start treatment already. Whenever you know everything I tell and you want to proceed faster, please let me know. So now we have patients who were diagnosed as smoldering myeloma. A part of these patients, we now start treatment earlier because of the high plasma cell level, FLC ratio, or MRI. So still there are patients with smoldering myeloma. And should we treat those patients? And those patients we don't know yet. So I think it's very important to promote and ask patients to participate in clinical trials. And so we will know whether other patients with smoldering myeloma with other characteristics than I showed here will also benefit from earlier treatment. So, and there are several clinical trials now going on in Europe in order to learn more about that. So that about the new criteria which are now implemented in the clinical practice. So the treatment of younger patients being transplant eligible. The current standard of care in many parts of Europe, and I know Europe is very diverse, but when you would have had access to these drugs, you would like to start with bortezomib, a proteasome inhibitor, which I think is necessary in all induction therapy for patients who are younger and transplant eligible, plus either thalidomide or cyclophosphamide. I think the French have shown that thalidomide is superior, so you would like to give thalidomide, and the Italian colleagues did a retrospective case analysis also showing that thalidomide is somewhat better than cyclophosphamide and dexamethasone, and then you perform a stem cell transplantation. But when we have the proteasome inhibitors available, the bortezomib and the IMiDs like thalidomide, the results were so good, the complete remission rates were so high, they were approximately the same with what we used to reach earlier with stem cell transplantation. So then there came the question in the Multiple Myeloma Society, do we actually still need an autologous stem cell transplantation, or could we only treat with the novel drugs? Well, there's several trials. I will show a lot of abbreviations. I'm sorry for that, but there are so many drugs. So it's good to have many abbreviations because we have so many drugs available. But V is bortezomib. That's because it's Velcade. K is carfilzomib, Kyprolis. Ixazomib is E. So these are proteasome inhibitors. I come to that later. So V, K, and I. The antibodies, daratumumab, elotuzumab. So you will read in many papers, dara, elo. The HDAC inhibitors, so this is Dutch, which is spanobinostat. The immunomodulatory agents, the IMiDs, which are thalidomide, lenalidomide, pomalidomide. And we have, of course, melphalan, which is still being used and very effective, cyclophosphamide, prednisone, and dexamethasone. But I will repeat whenever necessary. So is a stem cell transplantation still needed? This is the Italian study. Either an autologous stem cell transplantation or cyclophosphamide, lenalidomide, dexamethasone, all patients receive maintenance treatment. And when you now look to the progression-free survival, so the duration before the disease is relapse, that's much longer when you perform a stem cell transplantation, 43 months versus 28 months when you don't give a stem cell transplantation. So you postpone the relapse very pronouncedly by performing a autologous stem cell transplantation. So not only novel agents, but novel agents plus a stem cell transplantation. And also when you look to overall survival, we can't say exactly whether that's better. There might be a trend that also the overall survival is better. And we will do meta-analysis of many trials which have been performed in Europe, because such a similar trial has been done in France, also a similar design, with almost exactly the same progression-free survival in the transplant arm and in the non-transplant arm. So a stem cell transplantation is of added value. We performed a study in the Netherlands showing exactly the same, the benefit of a stem cell transplantation. And also the English, the MRC, performed a trial comparing just novel agents with a stem cell transplantation, and again, a stem cell transplantation was of added value. So a stem cell transplantation is required, and now we are even asking ourselves, maybe even two, because we did an Italian-Dutch trial, which was an EMN trial, and Dr. Zonneveld and Dr. Cavo at the latest ASH and the ESCO presented the data. And when you look now to the patients who got two stem cell transplantations, so you got novel agents, one stem cell transplantation, a second stem cell transplantation, and then maintenance therapy, you see when you look to the high-risk multiple myeloma patients, and the high-risk multiple myeloma patients are the patients with specific cytogenetic abnormalities in their chromosomes. Not because of it's an inherited disease, but during the course of your life, you develop abnormalities in your chromosomes, and then you develop multiple myeloma. And that the patients with a abnormality on chromosome 17, so a deletion, they lose a part, the translocation between chromosome 4 and 14, and the translocation between chromosome 14 and 16, so they stick together, these three abnormalities we know is very high risk in multiple myeloma. And we know the outcome of those patients is inferior as compared to the rest of the patients. Now, when you look to the high risk patients, defined as I just stated, you can see that when you perform two stem cell transplantations, the delay of the disease, of the progression, is much longer in the patients you transplant two times. Here you see the curve for two times, so you start with 100% of patients, and every time there's progression of the disease, the line decreases. And when you look to the patients who receive two stem cell transplantations as compared to one stem cell transplantation, you see that the progression-free survival is here 26 months and here 46 months. So a 20-month delay with two stem cell transplantation of the recurrence of your disease, that's almost 2 years. So we are now currently writing in the Dutch guidelines that when there's a high-risk patient with cytogenetic abnormalities, we would perform two transplants. This is a very early analysis. So there are some doctors saying, well, we'll have to wait maybe a little bit longer before to decide on that. So it's an individual balance, and you will discuss with your physician whether it's required or not. But in general, we are really discussing and thinking of two transplants in high-risk patients. So what about the maintenance therapy? So we were not used to give maintenance therapy after a stem cell transplantation. But that was actually because we hardly had any medication to give as a maintenance therapy. In earlier times, was in that practice, we gave melphalan as a maintenance therapy, but it was very toxic, and it didn't increase the overall survival, and the progression-free survival was a little bit superior sometimes, but sometimes not. But here you see the curves with lenalidomide, and a low dose of lenalidomide, an IMiD, most of the patients will be able to continue that for a very long time, although many patients experience complaints like feeling exhausted, diarrhea, but diarrhea, we have some medication for that, and it's specific for lenalidomide. I'll come to that later. But here you see the maintenance therapy with lenalidomide, and again, the progression-free survival is much longer. So half of the patients will experience a relapse after 51 months, And when you have no lenalidomide treatment, half of the patients will have developed a progressive disease already after 28 months. So again, postponement of the progression of the disease. And it's not only the English trial, also the Italian trials, the French trials, the Dutch trials have shown similar data. And when you combine all these trials, you see that the progression-free survival is better, but also the overall survival is improved. So you will live longer with your disease using maintenance therapy as compared to having no maintenance therapy. The only hesitation we still have is in the high-risk patients, whether the overall survival is better, but also in high-risk patients, you will postpone your relapse. So now we know that it's difficult to have these drugs available in every country for maintenance therapy, but the EMA, the European Registration Authority, did state that there's registration for lenalidomide maintenance therapy. So that about the younger patients. What about the further developments? That is the incorporation of antibodies in the first line of therapy, and I will come to that later. So then about the newly diagnosed patients with multiple myeloma who are elderly and are not transplant eligible. It's difficult to state whether you're transplant eligible or not. There's a doctor from the USA, which is Bart Barlogy, and who states everyone is transplant eligible. I'm not convinced about that. Whenever you're over 75, the toxicity will be much, much higher. So patients over 75, you would certainly not give an autologous stem cell transplantation. But 65 was a very limited limit, so now we increase the limit to 70 years of age. We have an eyeball test, and we think, well, this is a patient who can receive a stem cell transplantation. But there are patients who are not transplant eligible, and there are two standards of care in Europe, either melphalan, prednisone, and bortezomib, or lenalidomide and dexamethasone. What about the last regimen? Should you give it continuously or only 18 cycles? I think that's very important in clinical practice for patients. Should you have your treatment all the time, or are you able to have a treatment-free interval, which might be very important, because then you won't experience the side effects of the treatment. Now, when you look to the latest update of the first trial, and the first trial investigated lenalidomide dexamethasone continuously, only 18 cycles, versus MPT. And what you can appreciate from this slide is that the overall survival is better with lenalidomide dexamethasone versus MPT. So when you have Lendex available, you would favor to treat patients with lenalidomide dexamethasone. But when you look to the overall survival, there is actually no difference in continuous therapy or 18. So in general, you could say only give 18 cycles, then you have a treatment-free interval, you will have a treatment holiday, they say sometimes, and you will have similar overall survival. The only thing I would like to say is that when you have a very good partial remission or a complete response with this regimen, then your next treatment will only be in 6 years when you continue lenalidomide dexamethasone. So in many patients I see who have a very good partial response or a complete remission on Lendex, I would continue, because these patients do very well on the treatment and they will have their next treatment only 6 years later. So suppose you have a patient in front of you who is 76, his next treatment will only be when he is 82. And so then, and the next treatment will be a three-drug regimen with many side effects. So I wouldn't, in general, give 18 cycles. Patients with a very good partial response or complete remission, I would continue the therapy. Is it possible also to give it in the very frail patients? Because many patients are older than 70 and even 80 when they're diagnosed with multiple myeloma. And these patients are mostly not included in the clinical trials. So we don't know how these patients are experiencing the treatment. So first, what is frail? We know actually frail is not age. You have, this is a very nice documentary, this is Autumn Gold, and it's about the Olympics for very elderly patients, and this is in the category over 80. I don't know whether I will do that when I'm over 80, but of course we know we have also the over 80s who are like this, and I heard Cyril Lulin, which is a hematologist from France, once say, and so this is Black Yate, there are 50 shades of gray. So it's difficult to say who is frail and who is not frail. So we use now in general practice the frailty index. So we look to age, because over 80 really negatively impact the outcome, we know that. We look to the activities or daily living. Can patients dress themselves, bath themselves? We look also to the instrumental activities of daily living, which is, can they handle their telephone? Can they do their finances? And to the comorbidities. And the group of Antonio Palumbo in Italy has made a frailty index. And it's not on this slide, but it's very easy to do it online. I can provide you the link later on, so your physician can just answer all those questions. Then you get the frailty index. And we know that the patients who have a frailty index of 2 or more, we really should adapt the treatment. And when they have a frailty index, when they're unfit, having a score of 1, you also should adapt the treatment. So that's very easy to use in clinical practice. And I'm quite interested in trying to predict frailty even more better. So what we are also doing in the Netherlands is that we look to sarcopenia, so to the muscle fat ratio, because then when you have less muscle, you might have more side effects, because the pharmacokinetics of the drug is very different. And we also look to markers in the skin that reflect biological age. So we try to predict frailty more better even than with the frailty index. But coming back to the French trial, lenalidomide, dexamethasone, and MPT, is it also feasible in the frail? Well, we know that approximately 50% of the patients in the study were frail, so quite a lot in this study. And this is not the best slide, but when you look here, you see the fit patients here, the unfit patients here, and the frail patients here. You still see that the green line, which is RD, so Lendex, is in all the patients is better than MPT. So whenever you can treat a patient who is frail with RD, you would favor to give RD. But when you look here to the fit patients, the unfit patients, the blue line and the white line, we still have some steps to make for the frail patients, because the outcome for those patients is less. You see that their overall survival is less as compared to the fit patients. But you can use it, Lendex, in also in the unfit frail patients. So yes, better than MPT, but less effective than in the fit patients. So we need to do more. We in the Netherlands also look to MPV, the other standard of care in the Netherlands, melphalan, prednisone, bortezomib, and we only looked in unfit and frail patients. So 24% of the patients were unfit, 76% of the patients were really frail. And what we saw in these patients is that almost half of the frail patients, half of these, have to discontinue the therapy, the first 9 cycles. So it's very difficult to treat frail patients. But when you look to 6 cycles, that was possible to give in 70% of the patients. And their overall response rate was similar as compared to 9 cycles. So what in general will be done, I think, in clinical practice, whenever you have a frail patient or an unfit patient, give a shorter induction therapy, so only 6 cycles, 5 cycles, 4, we don't know, but give less, and then continue with maintenance therapy, because then you will have more effect. Shortly about the disease's relapse in general, and that will be discussed in the afternoon, please consider a second transplant if the first was very effective, because then you have a progression-free survival which is of benefit. And in general, you give lenalidomide, when you were treated with lenalidomide, switch to bortezomib and vice versa. There are several novel treatments. the novel proteasome inhibitors, I forgot the E here, this is Naples, when they didn't collect the rubbish. And when you look to the persons who were living in Naples at that moment, you see that there was a lot of stress at that moment. And that's actually the working mechanism of a proteasome inhibitor. Because when you look to a proteasome inhibitor, also in the cell, there's a rubbish bin. And the rubbish bin is the proteasome. And when you block the rubbish bin in your cell becomes stressed, and then your cell will die. And that is what a proteasome inhibitor does, actually. So bortezomib can do that only reversible. So when you gave bortezomib, it will block the proteasome, so there's rubbish in the cell becomes stressed and will die, but it goes on and off and on and off. And when you have carfilzomib, it will do that continuously. So we give now carfilzomib, which is even a more potent proteasome inhibitor as compared to bortezomib. We have the monoclonal antibodies, and it will be discussed later on in the morning and in the afternoon, which are daratumumab and elotuzumab. And what you see here with daratumumab, you see here the myeloma cell with CD38 on it. And when you give a monoclonal antibody, like here is the monoclonal antibody against daratumumab, it attracts several effector cells, and these are cells that are killing the myeloma cells. So the monoclonal antibody does something in itself. It can lead to cell death directly, but it also gets some friends to help to kill the plasma cells. So that's the working mechanism of daratumumab in multiple myeloma. And elotuzumab does something different. It also directly kills the myeloma cell, but it also activates the natural killer cell. Well, natural killer cell, it's all in the name. The natural killer cell will be activated and also kill the myeloma cell. So with daratumumab, you have friends helping to kill the myeloma cell. And here you have also a friend, which is the natural killer cell, which is activated by elotuzumab, and then the myeloma cell will be killed. This is the HDAC inhibitor, and I already see that I'm talking too long. So this is also kind of a rubbish bin blocker, because when you block the rubbish bin, which is the proteasome, and you also give panobinostat, you also block the second rubbish bin, which is the aggregosome, and when you block them both, it will be more helpful. So panobinostat is also a drug you can use. And I think the landscape totally changes with these novel drugs, because whenever I state when you were treated with lenalidomide, you give bortezomib and vice versa, now you have novel combinations, and you can see that the delay of progression of the disease is much better than only with two drugs. So suppose you have been treated with lenalidomide before for a long period of time because of maintenance treatment, and you develop a relapse, you would give normally bortezomib with a progression-free survival of approximately 10 months. So after 10 months, your disease will reappear. When you look now at carfilzomib, the irreversible rubbish bin blocker, you see that the progression-free survival is almost doubled, so much better. And when you combine bortezomib with other drugs, like panobinostat, elotuzumab, daratumumab, the progression-free survival was also better in these studies, and especially I think the use of daratumumab will really change the landscape, because the progression-free survival has not been reached. But here you see a number which is the hazard ratio, what means that you delay the progression of the disease with 100 minus 38%. So with 60%, 61% delay of the disease. So these drugs will really change the landscape of the treatment of multiple myeloma. There's one issue, and I think you will discuss that. These drugs are very, very expensive, and I think we really have to work together to get these drugs accessible in all parts of Europe and not only in the rich countries. And even in the richer European countries, it is a problem to have these available. because it's so expensive that also in countries like the Netherlands, daratumumab has been placed in the lock by the Minister of Health, so we don't have it available in combination, only in later lines. But we really should put an effort together, doctors and patients and you, in order to get it accessible, because this will really change the landscape of patients with multiple myeloma. Well, here you see it for the patients who have been treated with bortezomib. So bortezomib, then you have a relapse. When you only give lenalidomide dexamethasone, progression-free survival of 15 months. When you combine it with these drugs, it's much better, again, with daratumumab, not even reached. And you see that also in the patients with high risk, which I commented on earlier, the progression is being improved with the addition of several drugs. So also here, it is much better than before. Is there something simple? Because patients also want to have a pill instead of getting infusions two times a week, etc. I would like to show the data of something which is very easy to give and very, very cheap. And we developed that, actually Inge Nijhoff and Niels van der Donk in the Netherlands, in our institution. They observed that patients who were treated with lenalidomide and they were progressing on lenalidomide, so they were refractory. And when you give only one tablet of cyclophosphamide, which is very easy to give once a day, hardly any side effects, it's very, very, very cheap. When you add it to the lenalidomide, and we call it REP, lenalidomide endoxan, so cyclophosphamide prednisone, that 56% of the patients responded again for more than 12 months. And when you compare it to the other regimens I showed, which are rather expensive, I think this is really a good drug to give in every part of the world. And we don't know whether you should combine it with lenalidomide. Probably it does, because these results are much better than giving only cyclophosphamide. But I thought it would be nice to show that here. Pomalidomide, actually, when you compare this, 65% of response, 30% of patients who do respond. This is much better, not head-to-head compared, so it's not good for me to say that it's head-to-head compared, but when you look at it, this is a much more expensive regimen, 30% of patients and the duration of the response of 8 months. And think, when you have pay-for-performance models, it is very nice because you only pay for the 30% of patients who have benefit, and they will benefit for 8 months. So that's very worthwhile. So thinking about novel models in order to get it funded. This is the last slide, and then I think I will leave amyloid just hereafter to Professor Malini, because he knows much more, and then we have some time for questions. What about individualized therapy? Because now we treat all the patients in the similar way, maybe not only for high risk, it's a little bit different, like I said, the two transplantation, but this is something else which we can use. And I think what will be increasingly implemented in the clinical practice is the depth of the response. And I told you we looked to very good partial response and we looked to complete remission. We did look at stringent complete remission, so we looked at the FLC ratio. But still we know when we don't see anything by the eye in the bone marrow or by the free light chain ratio, there must be some disease because the disease recurs, relapses. So there must be some disease. So are there very precise methods to detect the limited disease which is available in the bone marrow? And one of the possibilities to do so is to do effects analysis, so immunophenotyping of the cells, and you can find 1 in 10,000, 1 in 100,000 cells with such an analysis. What you do actually, I showed the cell with daratumumab, and I showed there was CD38 expression on the cell, but there's several markers on a cell which are present on a malignant plasma cell, but not on a normal plasma cell. So when you look to these characteristics with a immunophenotyping, with labeled antibodies, you can see 1 in 100,000 cells. I forgot to implement a graph of that, how it looks. But a French study recently looked at patients who were treated with bortezomib, lenalidomide, dexamethasone. They either got a stem cell transplantation or not, and then they received maintenance therapy, and they had this very precise method to detect minimal residual disease. And when you look to the patients who have no minimal residual disease anymore, so this is the upper line, and you look to the patients without progression, you see that here these patients progressed much less as compared to the patients who were still MRD positive. So MRD determination is a very prognostic marker. What we don't know yet is, should you now stop therapy in patients who are MRD negative or continue, because they might really do well with the treatment you're given. You should continue therapy, and you should change the therapy in patients who are MRD positive. So the next type of trials, which are now being developed and are started in some countries in Europe already, is to look at the MRD negativity and positivity, and then randomize the MRD negative patients with either stopping or continue therapy, and in the MRD positive patients, either continue therapy or add something different. And then we will know what to do with MRD negative patients and MRD positive patients, but it certainly will change the landscape and the trials in the coming years. It will have consequences for patients, because this can only be done in the bone marrow. So patients will have to say that they agree with having additional bone marrows, because when you want to do this, you should repeat your bone marrow after the treatment, after 6 months, after 12 months, after, because that's the only way we can learn. So that's the problem, I think, with these type of trials, but we really hope that with this we can individualize the treatment and make the world of multiple myeloma patients better, and especially know whether we can have a treatment-free interval in the MRD-negative patients or not. So I think it's really important. So I will leave this in the talk hereafter. I think that's much better, because then we have 50 minutes left for questions.
So we'll take some questions now. Please, Julian,
I would like to do a comment. It was the most appreciated talk, because you talked slowly that everybody could understand.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I complete whatever Anita said, that it was an extremely comprehensive, but I would like to say something else. I'm grateful for your remarks regarding the cooperation for the reduction of medication, because in front of sickness and death, we are all equal, and the medication should not be addressed only to the millionaires. But I also have a question for you, madame. Doctor, please, you have mentioned the newly emerged recommendation during EHA regarding the two-stem transplantation. You have also mentioned that for the young people, the recommended period between the two is 2-3 years. What about the other people, people over 50, between 50 and 65, who are also eligible to receive stem cell transplantation? What would be the recommended period? Because this has not, I did not hear it, maybe. And the second one, you mentioned the benefits of 46 and 26. 46 months after the first one, 26. Has it been established why a reduction of 20 months already? Are we talking about an overall benefit of 46 plus 26 all in general? Thank you very much.
Yeah. I will show the slides you're commenting on, I think. So this is the question you had about the two transplants.
Yeah.
So, sorry. Yeah, it's here. So we start with induction therapy, and then you do a randomization between either one or two transplants. And the patients who you give only one transplant, the disease will be suppressed for 26 months. In the patients, you will do two transplants, so approximately 3 to 6 months after the first transplant, you do a second transplant. The disease will be suppressed for 46 months. So the patients who got only one transplant, after a median of 28 months, they will have a relapse of the disease, and they will have another treatment. Your doctor will start another treatment. So finally, I think what is very important to see whether the overall survival is longer. Because, I don't see a flip over, but what you see also with maintenance, I think, is very important, because we had a lot of discussions with my patients, because when you suppress the disease for a longer period of time, and you live for approximately, I say 6 years, and you suppress the disease for 4 years, and then you have 2 years of additional treatment. And when you don't give maintenance, and you have a treatment-free interval, and your disease is relapse after 2 years, and you have 4 years of additional treatment, but in the end you both live 6 years, you would be able to omit maintenance therapy, because your overall survival is similar, and then you have a treatment-free interval. So overall survival is very important, but for maintenance, we show that the overall survival is better, so I would really favor maintenance. It would be better with a flip over what I'm saying now, I think, but maybe you understand. But so that's about the 20-month difference. This is a very early analysis, so I would like to wait the longer follow-up of the analysis. Yeah. Is this an answer to your question? Yeah, okay.
So thank you very much for the excellent update. You already answered my first question, so I have small questions for you. When you're talking about transplantations, you're always talking about autologous transplantations, right? Are there any trials with unrelated transplant settings? Yeah. This is the first question. The second is, do we expect a sort of cure in the near future without transplantation? Yeah. And what would be, because almost all of the audience is patient advocates, what would be your take-home message to these people? Because there are too many different protocols and the diverse landscape, etc. So what would be the take-home message for the advocates? Yeah. Thank you.
Your first question about allogeneic stem cell transplantations, either from a family donor or from a matched unrelated donor, will be discussed later during the day by my colleague. So what has been done with allogeneic stem cell transplantation? First, we didn't have all these drugs available. We did a allogeneic stem cell transplantation very late in the course of the disease, and we really know that that's not the time to do an allogeneic transplantation, because you only had the side effects and almost no benefit. Although, of course, there's several patients in the world who did benefit an allogeneic stem cell transplantation at that time, but when you take all the patients together, in general, there's no benefit in later lines of the disease. What we did then is that we said, okay, in later lines of the disease, it's not a way to go. Should we combine it in the young patients with an auto? So we do first an autologous stem cell transplantation, followed directly by an allogeneic stem cell transplantation. And there have been several studies performed in Europe, especially. And when you look to these studies, the final answer, I think, is that it's not of benefit in general, because the survival curves are similar, so it's not a general approach. But sometimes we as doctors, when patients are approximately 40 years of age, you might think about doing a allogeneic stem cell transplantation at the first relapse, not in the start. So auto-allo. So now we know the first relapse. Is that a place to go? And I have regular discussions with my patients at home, because when they're young and they only benefited from the autologous stem cell transplantation with novel agents for approximately 18 months, you know that you have many drugs available. But when someone is very young, certainly his life will be shortened. So then you think, well, should we give an allogeneic stem cell transplantation at that time? What I don't do is whenever there's the relapse already within 6 months after the autologous stem cell transplantation, we looked at the patients, we did an allogeneic, and all the patients sadly died. So within 6 months, the biology of the disease is so progressive that you won't save those patients with an allogeneic. Between 6 months and 18 months, I have very long discussions with my patients, and sometimes we do, and sometimes we don't. And it depends on the age, on the life, whether they have children, whether they have a job which they want to continue, whether they want to have the risk of dying in the first year, which might be 10% with an allogeneic, or they say, no, my children are 4 years of age, I really want to see them and grow older, and I know it's limited, but I don't want to die in the first year. So it's a very difficult discussion. So I can't give a very clear answer, not at late stage, not fully at the start. At first relapse, discuss with your patients what is wise to do. So that's about allogeneic. The take-home message, I think, it's always difficult to take-home messages. I dislike a world in which we try to say everything in one or two lines. And that's the trend that is increasingly being adapted in life, because this is such a difficult subject. This is so full of emotion. This is very hard to state in a one-liner. But I really think I grew up in the time when there was only melphalan actually available. And it is completely different at the moment. So I think these are much better times for patients with multiple myeloma, although you really don't want to have multiple myeloma. But whenever you're diagnosed with multiple myeloma, these are much better times because you have so many possibilities to treat and therefore extend life. Hopefully also in a good quality of life. I really think that there's an unmet need for the treatment of bone disease because it's really devastating. So we should look in depth into bone disease, in extramedullary disease, which is very difficult. But we have better outcomes for patients. And I think the take-home message then also is, and I said it earlier already, we would like to have access to all these novel drugs for all patients with multiple myeloma, and we'll have to work together also with pharmaceutical industry in order to find models to get these drugs paid. But times are much better, and we are having much better times also in the outpatient clinic when you're discussing, because there's a future for patients. So that's, I think, very important.
Yes, I have a question which might be specifically relevant to the new and very expensive drugs. How is the dosage decided, and what kind of studies independent from the pharmaceutical companies are performed to decide the dosage? To use myself as an example, I get on a special program daratumumab, but at much lower dosage than recommended by the pharmaceutical company, and it works very well. So that, of course, also will bring down cost if you can give at a lower dosage.
Yeah, I do agree. I think, of course, there are investigations how to dose the drug, and really also when these drugs are developed in actually all pharmaceutical industry, there is extensive research on the dosing because you want to have the drug available for the patients, but also on the market for pharmaceutical industry. So whenever the dose is too low, it won't be good. So there is extensive investigations. What I think is difficult with the monoclonal antibodies is that there is a difference between the traditional pharmacokinetics and the long-term effect, because we did a lot of research on daratumumab in our own laboratory, and what you see is that there's not only a anti-myeloma effect, but it really changes the immune environment in patients, because it also affects the T regulatory T cells, which are suppressing T cells. It activates cells which are able to kill myeloma cells, and the long-term effects might even be just more immune modulation than direct killing. And we don't know what the pharmacokinetics is. So you, in this case, you can't blame that we didn't do the research at lower doses because there was an unexpected effect of the drug. And I think what we really should look for, and I agree with you, that knowing this, it's very interesting to look, can we give it once in 4 weeks, once in 8 weeks, once in even less. And also what we have available in our university, and I think that's also very interesting, is the immunopath method. So what we can do is that you can label the drug with a radionuclide, and then you can see whether the drug is actually going to the tumor, because we also know in multiple myeloma that is a patchy disease. So when we measure levels in the blood, it might not reflect what is available in the tumor. So I think also for immunopath, there's a role. So there's a lot to be done. It is a little bit more difficult than only blaming industry, but I do agree with you that we should look in depth and also look some of the oral drugs you give a certain amount every day, but maybe you can do it once every other day. And we know that when you buy, by example, 25 milligram versus 5 milligram, that the 5 milligram is relatively more expensive than the 25. So when you can taper the dose over several days, you will save money. So it's interesting. It's really interesting, and I do agree.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Zuckerman. And now we'll have a 10-minute break. If you have questions, you can approach.
I have a question. I'm coming from Croatia, and one problem in which I know that there is a problem is I'm not quite sure. I think I don't need it. You mentioned during this discussion, you mentioned the question of old patients with frail. Bones. Actually, I think that it is not clear what is the protocol for all patients that have actually that problem. Because in our country, no one wants to talk about that. In each hospital, they know that is a problem with the bones that is very sensitive. You have to take care. But from our point of view, they have to do some exercises, whatever, and I don't know how to express it. What is in your country? Is there any protocol about that? Or what is your opinion about that? Because that is what we would like to improve in our country. Okay.
Thank you. Yeah, so you have two types of frailty, I think. Where I was talking about was just frailty in general, so frail persons or unfit persons who are not able to do everything in life because of old age, but also because of comorbidities. For this type of frailty, it is important to see whether they are frail, and you can do it very easily with the IMW Frailty Index, and I will provide the link, and you should adapt the therapy. So lower the therapy, give less intense induction therapy, and then continue with maintenance therapy. So that's the kind of frailty in which you would adapt the therapy. Frail bones is also important, because bone disease in multiple myeloma can be really devastating. And I think what has been shown, that whenever you got multiple myeloma, you should give something which inhibits the osteoclasts, because the osteoclasts are the cells that are eating the bone. And when you give drugs that lower the activity of the osteoclast, less bone will be eaten, you get less osteoporosis, and we know you will have less fractures and less bone disease. These are the bisphosphonates. And the bisphosphonates you should give in multiple myeloma patients for at least 2 years every month. And you can either use intravenously pemidronate or zoledronate. What to do after 2 years, we actually don't know. I think whenever there's still active disease, you should continue the therapy, in, by example, every 3 months. So lower the frequency, but continue bisphosphonates. We're really looking for drugs that are also increasing the osteoblasts, because your bone is eaten by the osteoclasts, but being grown by being produced by the osteoblasts. And we know, by example, that the proteasome inhibitors, like bortezomib, are increasing also the activity of the osteoblasts. So for bone disease, we think that bortezomib is a very good drug, but it's not really very well investigated. So, but for bone disease, bisphosphonates, 2 years every month is, I think, required and should be done in patients with multiple myeloma. I hope I answered your question. The exercises, yeah, that's difficult. But I think whenever you're able to do exercises, you go to a physiotherapist, and it's good to do. You should, of course, be careful about the spine, because it's just exercises in a controlled way, not doing weightlifting, etc., but in which you keep your muscles in a good condition. That's, of course, is good, because when your muscles in a good condition, it starts, and it's along the spine, and it will help. It will be helpful. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much. And before the coffee break, we'll have a short brief by Ananda about the logistics.